Monica, thank you so much for being on our show today.
My absolute pleasure, absolutely. As you know, I know you quite well, and we've had lots of lovely conversations, so this is going to be great.
Thank you. So I just want to start off with a simple question. Can you tell us a little bit about your early childhood and how does it relate to your current public speaking journey?
Well, I was always quite loud but anxious, so I didn't mean to offend or upset. I was just very enthusiastic. And from a young age, I loved to write plays, and my siblings, I'm the oldest in my family, were all the actors, and I cast them and directed them, and I loved them performing the plays, and that turned into me writing musicals. And I had a business doing that for many years. And I worked as a professional theatre director for a while. Mm-hmm. Being away from home for a long time was quite difficult. And then I ended up working as a trainer and facilitator. Then I found out about Professional Speakers Association. So I joined up with them in 2019. And here I am today.
Amazing. So were you born in New Zealand?
Yes, I was born in New Zealand. I'm from Southland, down the bottom of New Zealand. We're just a very small group. I think there's still only about 90,000 New Zealanders. So everybody knows everyone.
South Island?
Yes, down the bottom of the South Island, and originally come from a rural farming community.
Amazing. Do you have an issue with the confidence when you were growing up?
I was always very anxious, but I was always had this gift of being able to speak.
Okay, sure.
Not everybody would have called it a gift sometimes. I was, be quiet, be quiet, be quiet.
No, but it's a gift. It's a gift.
It just happened. It just happened. Mm.
I know you're training all these individuals and corporates in public speaking. How do we speak in a way so that everyone wants to listen to us? What I want to understand is there any framework to have a better communication or a better speech?
There totally are frameworks that can make you be heard more clearly, that your message is far more effective, and that's what I love working with people to do. So I speak about proactive communication, and that's using words and stories that create solutions. Quite often we can be very negative in our speech and we get stuck in describing problems. So I come in and work with organisations with a set of skills to teach people to be far more proactive.
Sure.
And you know, one of the biggest issues is people using what I call redundant words. We can water down our very important messages just by adding in these words that are just bad habits. Mm-hmm. For example, you know, I mean, and that kind of thing. And stuff like that. And if you know what I mean. And of course the R's and the arms, which are fine to use. However, if you're doing it all the time, then it is a problem. And I think the biggest thing is really, Latha, is that we forget that we are the boss of our own words.
Sure.
You are the boss. You are the boss of what's coming out your mouth. And we don't pause or take control of that.
Sure. Is there any specific framework? Is it like, okay, I have to be emotionally speaking like this? Or is it like, oh, I have to consider in terms of like physically how I dress up? Is there anything more important than just the words?
Oh, absolutely. I think it's a full package.
Sure.
So it's like this. We need to be able to make an emotional connection.
Sure.
We need to be able to make a social connection, particularly if you're speaking to a bigger group. We need to be able to make an intellectual connection that we have information to give. And we also need to be able to make a sensory connection. So we are meeting the needs of everybody that we're speaking to.
Sure.
But when you learn these skills, you're able to then have them in one-on-one situations. And when you're learning to speak proactively, particularly in your workplace or your organisation, your words are geared towards solving problems and still maintaining good relationships. So I have a lot of templates. For example, a really simple one is name it, claim it, frame it. So if you're working in a team in an organisation and there's a problem, you might be able to sit down and say, name what's going on for you. And either one word or one short statement. And that makes you want to think about what's going on.
I see.
For example, some people might be, this is going wrong and that's terrible. Name how you're feeling. So it might be, I'm disappointed in the outcome. Claim what you did is the next one. Well, I assumed, Latha, that you knew what to do. You knew how to operate this new machinery. So I'm going to claim that because I do know and I should have showed you what to do. And in the future, I'm going to frame it that I'm going to check that everybody in the team knows what to do. And if you work in a team and you're sharing that, people start to just use, it's just three words. Name what's going on for you, and that's usually an emotional feeling of the outcome.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Claim what you did rather than you should have known what to do and they didn't do that and nobody was on time. And that just creates friction and it doesn't work towards proactively solving a problem. So name what's going on, claim what you did, and frame how you would do something differently in the future. And you'll find everybody else in the team will put that on the table and come up with a proactive solution. So that's just one small tip.
Amazing. Then what are the great qualities of an effective speaker?
Oh, well, I'm going to say that one of the most important parts, claim your words, own them.
Sure.
Be the boss of your word. And that comes down to slow down and also the pause. The pause is one of the most important strategies. It lets people catch up with what's going on. It lets people process what you're sharing. And sharing is important. If you're going onto the stage, you're not going up there or speaking in front of a group of people. You're not going up there to give information. If that's your perspective, it's not going to work. However, if you're going to get up there and share information, that is different, and your information needs to be packaged in a certain delivery and looking at how you're doing it. We have bodies, and your body and your voice need to be projecting the same information. Your voice needs to be supporting what you want to say.
Sure.
So that's a lot. Pause.
Pause.
Take time. When you walk onto the stage or into a group, don't start speaking until you're still, until everybody's ready. And leave that time by pausing long enough for the audience to almost think, oh, has she forgotten what she's going to say? Because you'll have everybody's attention. Amazing. So that's just one tip. But there's so many, we won't be able to get them through them all today. But
when I get anxious, it's more common for me to talk faster. At that time, what should I do? Give me a practical tip at that time.
You're going to breathe and you're going to slow down. Pausing, as I said before, is crucial.
Sure.
If you're feeling stressed, slow down. Wait. Process what you're going to say next. And if you're practicing, if you're doing something in a public arena, have all your moves practiced just as much as your words. So for example, and use the stage really well, I tend to tell people at the start when they're learning to speak, walk, then talk. So you might say something, what if I told you that most people are terrified of speaking to a group of people? Walk to the other stage, the other side of the stage. That gives you time to think, what am I saying next? I'm very anxious. But by then, you're slowing yourself down, it's slowing your heartbeat down, you're breathing. And what if I told you that the reason why people get so upset and anxious about speaking is because of what I like to call, waiting, pausing, unsubstantiated fear? Then you could walk back into the middle, look at your audience and say, and what if I told you that I'm going to share three tips with you today that will guarantee that in time, this anxiety will stop. So all I did was slow down what I was saying. I gave people the opportunity to move with their eyes, then I walked back into the middle. Another activity is to give people something to do. Stand up there about every 3 or 4 minutes, give the audience something to do or the group of people something to do.
That's beautiful.
Let's always do that. Put your hand up, put your other hand up, do this, do that, and there'll be a message in it at the end. So that's given me time to be on the stage or in the setting. They've got something to do. You've calmed down.
Sure. So it's almost like even giving them tasks give you time to relax.
Yes.
Sure.
Time is on your side. When you, again, are managing the time, you're managing what's going to be happening. You are the boss of your words.
Sure.
You've been walking all your life, just about. You can walk to here, have that all pre-planned. Practice as well.
Monica, you're a member of a public speaking association and you have interacted with a lot of public speakers, right? So from your experience, are people born with public speaking skills or can it be improved through practice?
Well, we're born with the ability to speak.
Sure.
But like anything, there's skills involved. But I do need to say that the Professional Speakers Association is mostly about the business of speaking, because professional speakers make their income from speaking in public. However, we do offer and share by having, I've just spoken at an international conference in India, and I did speak on delivery, so you can come along to a conference, you can approach other members to get some coaching, to learn how to use the skills in a more professional manner, how to take your message and deliver it.
Sure. In this case, do you train individuals to be effective speakers? So what's your training look like?
So I do work, I myself trained, I went along and became an associate of the Trinity College in London for communication and public speaking, and I had to sit a very rigorous exam. The examiner comes from London.
Wow.
You have to deliver 5 speeches, 5 minutes long, exactly on 5 completely different genres. At the end of those 5 speeches, you are examined on what technique you used and why you did it, according to the type of speech that you've delivered.
Interesting.
And that's quite stressful. And then you're given an unknown speech. My one was a young woman delivering something to the government in England, in Parliament. So I had to read it. I got to then I had to deliver it using special techniques and then speak about what techniques I used and why I used them.
Amazing. Just curious, how long was the course?
The course? Mm. Well, I had actually completed speech and drama as a child and when I was older, and so I just went straight into the associate level, and because I'd been working as a facilitator and a trainer and with my background in theatre as well. So I went straight into it. I think for me it was over about 4 months. I worked with a coach myself. But everybody does need a coach when you're asking, is it something you can naturally do? It's something you can learn and hone in on.
Sure.
Just having information to give to people.
So that means we can learn, even if we don't. Okay, perfect.
Oh, absolutely. Some people are naturals, but they still learn the craft of moving on stage. And that's where my theatre background has been phenomenally helpful to me and to the people that I coach.
Amazing. So how much does body language and gestures help in public speaking?
Huge, absolutely. We have a voice-body relationship. Now, for some people, that comes naturally. But some people have a habit that they might be doing this all the time, and after a while. And the other thing that people tend to do is move on their feet a lot. Looks like they're doing the box step. They're moving around and back and forward. And then after a while, the listener starts to feel seasick. So it's really important to know that every move must be intentional.
Interesting.
For example, I've just done that because it was a key word, intentional. And you need to match the move with what you were saying. For example, I might be saying, so here I was amongst all these people. And suddenly I had an epiphany, for in that moment I realised, and then I'll carry on with it, because you're creating the drama and the effect. You know, it's just, think about watching television, if the actors didn't move, then it's not going to be as interesting. And in this day and age where people's attention spans have become a lot less, we need to do a lot more work to be engaging.
Sure. Then what's the perfect body language for someone speaking? I know we have to keep moving around, but if they are in a normal position, what's the best body language?
Well, everybody is unique, so if I'm coaching somebody, I will ask them to walk around as they naturally will. I've got a friend who is an excellent speaker. She's very tall, and she stands behind a lectern, and she wears high shoes always, and she's very, very still. But her story is so, in itself, is so attention-grabbing, and because she's tall and wears a bright colour with her very high shoes, it has an impact. That would not work for me. Everybody has something that is part of their, like, we call it charisma, or, and these days everybody's got riz, which is just a new colloquialism for, they have a special way. So some people speak very quietly. For me, it's my voice, because it is the most, it's quite strong, so I've learned to use it. I used to speak with a high pitch that never suited me. But there are a number of skills that you could use generally. So concrete in your shoes, you only move if you need to to deliver your message. You must move, but at the right time. Hand gestures, I'm being open. Important word is coming out. Well, sometimes I'm straight and my arms are away. It depends on what you're speaking about. It is practice, and again, I recommend you get yourself a great coach if this is what you want to do.
Sure, sure. I've seen many times the president speaking. Probably I've seen their previous videos and I couldn't feel like they have known anything about public speaking, and suddenly they're in the world stage and they're doing great. So I can see that the tone of voice is so important in how they deliver. Even when you speak now, I felt it. Like at one point you spoke a little bit in a high pitch and low. Tell us about how important is the tone of the voice.
Absolutely crucial. So as a simple tip to get going with, start your sentences high. So how is everybody today? And when you go down at the end of your sentence, you're creating a sense of authority. Because if you do it around the other way, so, how are you today? It doesn't sound right or feel right. And New Zealanders do have a habit of going up at the end of their sentences. And suddenly it's very difficult to take them seriously. And I am exaggerating right now.
I can feel it.
Yes. So you start up. So what I'd like you to do today, so I've started up and coming down. So something you could do to practice this, and I got this from my own speech coach when I was doing my associate of Trinity College, is to use the stringed instruments in an orchestra. It's easy peasy to learn to stretch out your voice. So you have a violin, a viola, a cello, and a double bass. We normally do this standing up, but I'll just quickly show you. So by going, violin, viola, cello, double bass, you're stretching out your vocal cords, and you're learning about your range. So after a while, this comes naturally.
Sure.
And you're giving yourself a sense of authority.
Wow, interesting. Being a business owner, talking to a lot of clients, other business owners, selling is one of the important jobs that I do. You talked about authority. How do I build my authority? How can I communicate with that authority to other people?
Well, just noticing with you, Latha, you speak all of your syllables. Communicate with authority, so that's great. But I have noticed you're speaking on the one note, and another thing that we all do. So it's sounding the whole time. So you're going to try this. Monica, how could I speak with more authority? And you're going to drop it down and even do it with your hand for a start to get going. Why don't you try that now?
Monica, how can I speak with more authority?
already. Authority.
Authority.
So, yes, perfect. So you went down then. Or authority. And the other thing you can do, and this is a good thing to practice as well, putting your hands on your tummy and letting the words go, authority, and you're actually using this muscle. So it's authority.
Authority.
Yes, perfect.
Amazing. Interesting.
So practicing that will definitely be beneficial.
What is happening psychologically from starting in a high pitch and go to a lower pitch with people?
Well, you heard it. So, for example, if I was speaking sales, I would be Latha. It's not that this is an expensive program. It's going to be the cost if you don't take it on. You are going to miss out. And I do not want that for you. So when you're going down, it's that stronger, deeper sounding. And it just resonates with people.
Fascinating. So what's important? Is it the content that we speak, or it's how we deliver it, or both?
Absolutely, it's got to be both. Some people have gone up and delivered the most incredible content, but after 2 minutes, people have stopped listening because it wasn't packaged with the connection in mind. I call that synergy with for success. So it's creating relationships with people, making sure the people have come to you and you've come to them. And how are you going to do that? I have a lot of activities when I'm delivering my presentations. I have people dancing to no music, and there are people that would never think that they're going to do that. I often go down to the floor and have them on the stage. Moving your body. For some people, they want to speak like suddenly we've got our elbows attached to our middle and we look like we're flapping around. But learning to use your body, extending back. I've got short legs and long arms, so I needed to practice pulling up, not pulling my shoulders back, but lifting my ribs up when I'm on the stage. It just creates more authority. So it is the whole package.
Amazing.
But there's a few tips, like, for example, if you're speaking about something, if you're selling, this is the cost. You will not be able to do this, this, and this. It should always be three. There's a reason why fairy stories, the three little pigs, the three blind mice, come in threes. We remember three. We are affected by three. So the rule of three is very useful.
Interesting.
And then always two choices. It's going to be like this, or it's going to be like that. And then you're going to slow it down. The decision is yours, Latha, using a person's name if it's one-to-one. Because I never speak to 2,000 people. I speak to that person and that person and that person and that person, and sometimes we get really nervous, but the conversation is just as vital if it's between two people as it is a whole group.
Amazing. When you're speaking to 1,000 people, 2,000 people, how do you build that relationship with every single person?
It depends. It really does depend on the vibe that's going on the room, and I do work with people about reading the room.
Sure.
So two examples come to mind. At the end of last year, I was at a very large school prize giving, and everybody was talking, and I was behind a podium. So I stepped to the side of it, and I moved the microphone so it could pick up my voice. And I did a greeting in te reo, and nobody was expecting it coming from me. So they immediately looked, and that settled everybody.
Wow. So it's still in the voice and the tone and your body language that you build connections.
Yes.
Not like you're speaking to a single person.
No. I'm addressing each single person. I still think that person needs my attention, so I want to get them all, but I don't think of them as a collective group. I think, everyone's talking, I can't get that person's attention or that person's attention. And then just recently when I was speaking in India, I had to get up and do a sales pitch for what I was going to be speaking about in my 90-minute workshop. So I was the third person to speak, so I got up and said, if you are totally happy with the way you're speaking, then do not come to my workshop. If you are satisfied with the way you are using your body and your voice, then do not come to my workshop. Sure. If you are interested, or if you are not interested in developing a synergy for success with your audience because you've already got that, then do not come. I use psychological, playing the opposite game, really.
Sure.
So lots of people came to the workshop.
Amazing. It's interesting. So you're training people here, and you said that you went to India. So do you do the international training often?
Yes, well, that was a wonderful opportunity through the Professional Speakers Association. So in New Zealand, we are part of the Global Speakers Federation. So there are 17 other countries. And within, members get the opportunity to apply to be able to speak on the stage. So I've just finished speaking in India, and I'm off to speak in Perth on the 15th of March at the Professional Speakers Australia Association. So that's where the international comes in, but was also able to do some work in Melbourne privately on my way over and on my way back.
So you do workshops, and do you also do one-to-one kind of training?
Yes, I do coach. I tend to only take a small number of people, and I do have a waiting list this year. So I have two different types of coaching. I have an intensive weekend, so people, we have an apartment set up at our home where people can come in. I will listen to them, I'll hear their stories, and then we'll package that up into their needs for how they want to speak. Because public speaking, any time you've got more than one person, it's public.
Exactly.
So it's learning to have those kind of proactive conversations that get people to where they want to be. So I've coached people, for example, a young woman that wanted to go to Harvard University. I helped her with her interviews, and she got into Harvard. To corporates that want to deliver their keynotes. I have a couple of young women who are incredible. They want to deliver and speak in the diversity inclusivity realm, and they both have Down syndrome. But that is just part of who they are, and they are the most incredible speakers. So watch this space.
Sure. Next one I want to talk about is stories. I moved to Melbourne 4 months ago, and I put up a post on LinkedIn which said, I spoke with my husband 10 hours straight. He was helping me, because he's still here in New Zealand. So he spoke with me for 10 hours straight, and he helped me with renting a home, renting the office, car insurance, buying the car. I mentioned that post on LinkedIn, and I met someone yesterday, and she said, oh, I remember that story from you, how your husband helped. That was so fascinating. It was 4 months ago, and she just read somewhere. It's not me speaking. She read it, and she still remembered the story. How much is storytelling important in public speaking?
Oh, absolutely huge. So if it's not an activity you're giving people on the moment to create their own story, I went and I heard the speaker, and we did this, and it changed my thinking. Then you use a story. I heard a story about, and it's usually got to do with vulnerability. So if you said, my husband and I had a conversation for 10 hours and I wasn't forcing him to have it, that means, oh, what did you do that you could both speak for that long? Because as you know, women tend to have more words than men, but not always. And this is what we did together. It was a life-changing moment. I was scared, I was worried, but yet he told me, he was with me. And even though I went to Melbourne alone, I knew he was there because he'd been part of the process. So you don't do all the details, you create something emotional.
That was a great comparison about how I said it and how you said it.
Yes, so just turning it into the emotion.
Sure.
I told a story recently, it was last year, I was over in Orlando at the National Speakers Association in America. I was at their conference representing New Zealand as the president at the time. And long story short, but I missed my flight in Houston. So I reframed it. Houston, we have a problem. That's something that people would identify with. And then I started off with saying, I've watched far too many movies where people are murdered in car parks at 2 o'clock in the morning. So when I'm standing there alone and afraid in a foreign country, wondering when my Uber was going to arrive, I wasn't feeling great. So then people wanted to read the rest of it because you set the scene, talk about the emotions, and then have the punchline. And it's that people all, we're all human beings, we all experience moments of vulnerability. And usually it's got to be something, it's going to be a story with a great ending, how you worked out the problem.
Sure.
Because obviously you always had a great ending. You've gone to Melbourne, you're experiencing success, your husband is still supporting you. And so when it is difficult, you know he's there for that 10-hour conversation if needed.
And it's interesting that when she saw that and she saw the similarity in how I was explaining, and it kind of built the trust while we shared that story. Beautiful.
Yes.
And give me an active, practical tip about how I can improve this podcast.
How you can improve on this podcast? I think you've got a great face. It's smiley. It's going to look wonderful on the camera. And you are genuine. You're authentic. You prepared questions. Mm-hmm. You thought about who I was. And I think this has been a wonderful podcast. So you're really interested in people. You shared your own story. We had discussions.
Sure.
And of course, I can't unpack every skill for public speaking, but we did some, went over some general skills. Even public speaking professionals really struggle with their words. But if you're confident, then it's okay. Mm-hmm. I did hear a story a few years ago about a professional speaker who fell off the stage.
Oh, no.
And he just said, I'm going to open this up to the floor now. So you can turn anything into something else.
Sure.
Yes.
Sure. And one of the other biggest mistakes people do, and even I have the same challenges, saying, you know what I mean? The filler words. How do we overcome that?
That is practice. Instead of having those filler words, pause.
Beautiful.
It's perfectly fine to pause. So if somebody from a group of people that I'm working with has a question for me, it's fine for me to just look. Repeat the question. So you would like to know how many times I've made a mistake on the stage. And my answer to you is this. I can pause and go, what am I going to say? What am I going to say? What am I going to say? More times than I care to think. Because through making mistakes, and if you're a proactive communicator, you're going to flip those mistakes into learnings. So next time, the same error or mistake won't happen.
Sure.
We're never going out there to be perfect.
Sure. Even the pause kind of gives that authenticity and also the authority.
And it's beautiful. I am genuinely processing an answer that's going to best serve you. And we do tend to get very heightened. And I speak about the cost of not speaking proactively. And I use the acronym HELP. When you're anxious, you're going to get heightened. You're going to start speaking like this. Your heart rate's going to go. You're going to become a shallow breather and your message won't get out. So that's number one. Your energy is going to change to not of one of authority. So that's really going to do the next thing, which is going to limit the effect of your message. So you're going to get heightened. Your energy is going to change. You're not going to be up there controlling even your own words because you're panicked, you're anxious, you're frightened. I just use the rule of three. You're panicked, you're anxious, you're frightened.
Amazing.
Just to put that in. And then you're going to say, and it's going to limit your impact with the audience. Then we're going to get up to the next one, which is the P, and that is your performance is not going to get the rating that you're looking for as a professional.
Wow, interesting.
So that's HELP, and that is the impact of when you are not going along training, finding out skills. So I do recommend that people do find somebody that can help them, whether it's your local Toastmasters Club. They are phenomenal. They do excellent work. I've had the privilege of speaking at Toastmasters conferences.
Sure.
about helping people to public speak more effectively.
Sure. Can people like students and young professionals, can they go to Toastmasters?
Oh, absolutely. They are a phenomenal group. But if you're interested in speaking as a business, then Professional Speakers Association is the place for you. And it offers so much.
Sure.
So much.
Amazing. Glossophobia, the fear of public speaking. According to the National Institute of Mental Health, USA, around 75% of the world population has the fear of public speaking. What are some practical tips for someone to overcome that fear?
Well, I'm just going to start out by saying this, and this is something I do say to people a lot, that words are the most powerful force available to humanity. Yet how much time do we spend considering how we use our words? Look, if I want to develop a relationship with you, whether it's a working relationship or a social relationship, I need to know how to deliver my words so that what's going on inside me from my internal perspective is delivered to your external perspective of me. Sure. So it's crucial. And the fear comes from the idea that it's just me and them. And that's why I reduce it down and thinking, I'm just speaking with one person, and one person, and one person, and one person. And a great tip is to find one person within your group for a start when you're getting going, and just maybe eye to eye with them. You can move your eyes above everybody else. So there's so many tips you can use.
Sure.
But that is interesting.
I'm sure it's a long thing.
Yes.
Amazing.
Yes, the more you speak, the more you speak.
Someone new to the public speaking want to learn more about it. Where do they start? Is it Toastmasters?
You could go to Toastmasters. You could go and speak at your local Rotary Club. We would say there's different clubs. Probus. There's so many different clubs that are available. Go along there to tell your story. Think about what your message is. You could do it that way. There's many inroads.
Sure.
If you feel that you've got a gift for it, if you've got a theatre background, if you want to deliver an experience, if you are a celebrity, you've done something and then you want to get out and share with the rest of the world, if you've worked really hard and developed a great business and you want other people to understand that they could do this too, then get out there and start doing that.
Sure.
But I do recommend a speaking coach, or coming to workshops, and I'm sure there's plenty that are available. I'm happy to put people in touch with other people that do that. So it's not a one-size-fits-all like it never is, because we're all unique people.
Amazing. Who are your current clients? What sort of people just contact you? The reason why I'm asking is, who needs a professional speaking coach?
Well, I have a variety of clients, and as I started out, I was originally working with people doing Trinity College and New Zealand Speech Board exams.
Sure.
So I did that. Then I moved into helping adults, and they come from just word of mouth. I don't think I've ever advertised. And then I'll take them for, sometimes it's a short time, somebody wants to prepare something that they're doing at work, but I also go in and work in corporate organisations with how to speak to each other within your organisation. And something that I have a huge energy for is that so many organisations have a wonderful mission statement and vision and purpose and values that they could be using within the organisation in their words every day.
Sure.
But if I approach one of the employees and say, what's the vision of this company or this organisation or this educational institute? And they'll say, I don't know. So there's a real disconnect. So I challenge organisations, if I walked into your organisation tomorrow, what would I experience, feel, see, and know, and hear that reflects the vision, mission, purpose, and values of what your organisation is about? So if everybody is using these wonderful words, so Lathi, you might come into my organisation and not be happy about something and want to complain to me. And I would be able to say, well, as you know, Lathi, one of the strong values of our organisation is that we work collaboratively with our clients. So let's work this out together. Mm. So when you've got that phrase, it's cutting down a whole lot of the conflict. It's reducing it by saying, let's work together. Because at our organisation, the XYZ company, we work together with our clients. Mm, or you might have a mission that within 24 hours, all of the staff, each staff member is going to provide an answer for a client.
Sure.
So that's your mission. That's what everybody does.
I have so many questions to ask you. I know we are running short of time.
Yes.
But I really want to invite you for another episode because there is a whole new information about being present online. Because
yes.
After COVID, we have all information online. And how do we present ourselves online better? So I'll definitely invite you for a second episode. But what I want to know now is, how can people contact you? I know you're a keynote speaker, you're emceeing, and you're training individuals, corporates, and you're an award-winning author. So
yes.
How do people contact you?
Quite simply, you can Google me, Monica Moore, two O's, M-O-O-R-E, speaker, should get you to me.
Sure.
Monica at monicamoore.net. You'll find my website. All my contact details are on there.
Sure. Perfect.
So
we'll make sure that we put it on the YouTube description.
Excellent.
Link, and then can
you
see. Tell us quickly about your book, because I know it's an award-winning book. Tell
us
quickly
about
the book.
Oh, yes, well, I did actually bring it along today. So
amazing.
This is my first book, and it was about me not having the confidence to do lots of things. Even though I was quite loud, I did lack a lot of anxiety and self-doubt.
Wow.
So what I did was I changed my words. And it's a story about me buying a dress. The book's called Buy the Damn Dress. It doesn't have anything really to do with the dress other than a story that changed the trajectory of my life. I realised that I needed to change the words I was using and the stories I was telling myself. And when you do that, everything changes.
Amazing.
So I got my good friend William Shakespeare. I love his words so much.
Me too.
And he has a quote at the beginning of every chapter.
Wow.
So however,
that's a good way to put it out.
I've been fortunate enough to be selected to speak on a cruise in April. So I'll be speaking on the cruise, and during the day I've got two more books coming out. And one is solely on delivery, and another one is about companies using their vision, mission, purpose and values, and how that can change and identify your branding, create a niche market and make it so much easier for you to be known to your clients for who you are and how you are. And who doesn't want that?
Amazing. Beautiful.
Excellent.
Thank you so much, Monica.
It's been my pleasure.
Wonderful. Lot of power-packed information. Thank you so much for
excellent. And look, I'll just finish. If anybody's interested in what I do for their corporate or their organisation or the educational institute, they can get one of these delivered to them. I'm happy to send it electronically or pop it in the mail for you.
So how do we do get this? Is it
just send me an email, Monica at monicamoore.net.
Amazing. Thank you so much for watching this today's episode. I will see you in the next one soon. I'm learning, you are learning, let's learn together. Thank you from Lata.